Good evening, everyone. My name is Neil Pandia. Thank you all for coming to the 15th monthly Cyberspectrum meetup. This event series serves as a forum for the exchange of knowledge and ideas related to software-defined radio, and generally aims to get people interested and excited about the applications that can be realized with SDR technology. Engineers, students, hobbyists, enthusiasts, and people of all experience levels are welcome, no matter what your software or hardware background. At each meetup, people from the community have the opportunity to present their work, projects, and ideas to the group. The event here tonight is being sponsored and hosted by Edis Research. Our first speaker will be Martin Brown, who will present the next episode of the GNU Radio Community Update. This month, there are numerous interesting announcements. Martin is a longtime contributor to the GNU Radio project and is the GNU Radio Community Manager. Most of the stuff that he touches is SDR related, and his day job is writing software for Edis Research, where he spent a lot of time in RF NOC, among other things. Our second speaker will be Kevin Reed, who will present
the title. I didn't hit the thing. That's Martin, everyone. And if you want to follow, you have to tell the live stream people this is Martin. And that's
And this is Martin. And if you want to follow him on Twitter, there's his handle.
Brown Noise.
Brown Noise.
Yes.
Our second speaker will be Kevin Reed, who will present a talk titled An Audible Waterfall Plot. AM receivers are useful for detecting a variety of signals.
That's the summary, not the title. So you can stop there. I just say it.
Let him talk about the rest of it.
Well, I was going to do the whole spiel, Kevin. AM receivers are useful for detecting a variety of signals and noise sources, even when they are not deliberately amplitude modulated. It is possible to implement a non-selective AM receiver, one which receives signal at a very large input bandwidth. This has been done in hardware. The classic crystal radio is an example, but more advanced designs are also made for aviation radio enthusiasts. A further refinement allows the signals to be spatialized, producing a stereo audio output where the sound is panned according to the relative RF frequency of the input, thus creating an audible waterfall. Recall that Kevin has spoken twice before at Cyberspectrum, so welcome back, Kevin. Our third speaker, and there's Kevin, and there's his Twitter handle if you'd like to reach out to him. Okay. Our third speaker will be Paul David, who will give a talk titled Adding Dual 10 Gigabit Ethernet Capability to the USRP X300. The USRP X300 currently supports a single 1 or 10 gigabit connection to the host computer. In this talk, he will discuss the various design challenges in adding support for two simultaneous 10 gigabit Ethernet links from the perspective of the FPGA, the UHD software driver, and different Ethernet cards, as well as give a brief demonstration showing the real-time monitoring of 400 megahertz of instantaneous bandwidth to view Wi-Fi and LTE signals over the air. Recall that Paul spoke at the previous Cyberspectrum. So welcome back, Paul. And there's Paul, up close. And there's his Twitter handle. Paul David is a graduate student at Virginia Tech, and he is currently an intern at Edis Research. He primarily focuses on wireless communications and software-defined radio, as well as software development. And time permitting, our fourth speaker will be our very own Balan Sieber, who will discuss some recent interesting experiments, such as a GNU radio spot jammer and an analysis.
Not tonight. Another time.
Well, since we started early, I guess we got this. Okay, next time. Next time, GNU Radio Spot Jammer and an analysis of a FMCW radar. All meetup presentations will be recorded and posted online, as well as streamed live on YouTube. The videos for all the previous Cyberspectrum events have already been posted. We have set up a channel on IRC on Freenode called #Cyberspectrum as a way for people remotely watching the live stream to contact the local group here in Santa Clara with any comments or questions, as well as to alert us to any audiovisual problems. Future meetup locations will alternate between here in Santa Clara and... We have set up a channel on IRC on Freenode called Cyberspectrum as a way for people remotely watching the live stream to contact the local group here in Santa Clara with any comments or questions, as well as to alert us to any audiovisual problems. Future meetup locations will alternate every month between here at Santa Clara at the Edis Research Office, and at Noisebridge up in the city. The next meetup will tentatively be held on Wednesday, May 18th at Noisebridge. Future details will be posted on the meetup page about 1 or 2 weeks prior to the event, so please tune in, pun intended, for all the details. Including a list of speakers and presentation topics. As always, if you would like to present something or if you have ideas about future topics, please let us know. We would like to thank all of our speakers tonight for their efforts and enthusiasm, and we would like to thank Edis Research for providing complimentary pizza and soda and for providing this space and hosting the meetup. I have a couple of announcements tonight. Last time we met, we talked about Cyberspectrum in Melbourne and how the group down there was organizing a Cyberspectrum meetup kind of modeled after what we do here. And they were meeting at, what was the funny name of that location?
The York Butter Factory.
Yes, the York Butter Factory. So that event happened and was a big success. And they're planning a second meetup. And it's going to be, I think, next month. And they're going to have an install fest. So if you're able to go, it's definitely worth the 17-hour plane ride to Melbourne. Their Qantas does 3 daily nonstops out of SFO, so just jump on one of them and head on down. Hey, why not? Another announcement is GNU Radio Conference. GNU Radio Conference is coming up in September. It'll be September 12th to 16th. Martin will talk more about that in just a minute, but it's a really, really good event, and we're expecting a record turnout of about 250 attendees, and it's on sort of the west coast, kind of in the middle of the country. It'll be in Boulder, Colorado this year, so not quite as far as Washington. So keep your eyes peeled. I think registration already opened, and Martin will talk more about that in just a few minutes. And last announcement is that Edis Research is hiring for a variety of positions. So if you'd like to know more about that, reach out to one of us, and we'll give you all the details. Okay. Thank you very much. We'll now get started with our first speaker.
I try and, you know, collect news every once in a while. Usually when we're here in this location, I talk about what's going on. SDR, mostly GNU Radio focused stuff. Actually, can you just like advance? I don't have a way to advance the slides. Tom, come in.
Next.
Oh, you want to just press play? Okay. GNU Radio, so I think this is something I should spend some time talking about. So GNU Radio is at least my favorite free software radio DSP tool, but there's really not that much competition. And the major announcement here is that the GNU Radio organization has undergone some pretty major restructuring. So Tom Rondo stepped down as the project lead after a couple of years of being the project lead, and he decided it was time to move on, and so we, like, the GNU Radio leads got together, and we sort of figured out a plan, and as of now, Ben Hilburn is now the new project lead for GNU Radio. But we didn't just, like, change out the project lead, we actually sort of started restructuring this whole thing. So we even have an organization chart, so we're that organized. So one thing that's new is that we have a project lead, which is sort of, I don't know what a good analogy would be, maybe like the CEO of GNU Radio, but that doesn't really make sense. But we have Jonathan Corgan as the chief architect, which is sort of a separate role. So I guess in a very real sense, both Ben and Jonathan are project leads, because, I mean, the technical decisions that Jonathan makes very central to what's going on in GNU Radio. But then we sort of defined sort of a bunch of other roles. So something that we had in the past was the working group leaders. So that's most of what we have in the middle. But we sort of identified a couple of areas where we just needed some more, people helping out. And most of them, we sort of figured out some roles. But there are a couple of very new ones, like reference apps is really something we've always wanted, but we've never actually focused. The same with analysis tools, something like, visualization, etc. Having it all in a very nice package. But there are a couple of other things that are sort of new. So for example, this whole operations area. So we have like someone who's like dedicated now to running the website, which has also been. I'm still the community manager, as that hasn't changed. But Nathan, for example, who is also like the main the project lead for Folk, is now the release manager for GNU Radio, which means that Jonathan is actually now fully focused on the technical development of GNU Radio. Excuse me. And then there's a couple of roles where we sort of still need to figure out who can fill them. So, you know, as all big organizations, we're definitely looking for volunteers. But really, we're not asking people to sort of immediately step up and do one of these things. Nothing really has changed in that sense, that we just, you know, we just want people to get involved with the community, start using the code, contributing, etc. And then we'll usually figure out, you know, who's suitable for what role as we go on. So Tom is still around, and he's actually still working on digital commons stuff. So one thing that we wanted to get straight before we have the 3.8 release, which is still not yet targeted for, but we'll have to happen one time sooner or later, is an actual like cleanup of that entire sort of digital modem thing. And it's looking very nice. And I'm really looking forward to getting that stuff merged. It'll be a big change, and there'll be some loss of backward compatibility, but I think it's all for the good. So does anyone have any questions on this? Because I'm pretty sure I haven't covered everything. I guess for most people, this won't be a massive change in their day-to-day life, unless you've been really intimately involved with the GNU Radio project. But I did want to emphasize that this is something that we sort of spend a lot of time working on. You know, we want to make sure that this is a project that is, you know, well-run and organized, and it's a very important project. Well, at least I think so, being involved in it for a couple of years. I guess I'm a bit biased in that sense. But okay, so there's a couple more GNU Radio announcements, or you could please move the next slide. So
Hank got the spinning wheel of doom.
Oh man.
So if I knew which order I had my slides in, then I just stopped talking. Well, there's a couple of other things that came out of this. I'm just gonna guess what's coming next. So one thing that we have been working on, for example, is the website, and I just really wanted to sort of point that out, but if you go to GNU Radio.org, you would have noticed immediately. So Ben has been working very hard on that, and that is definitely something that we have been meaning to tackle for a long time. Is this still loading the next slide, or is it? I'm still kind of.
It's thrashing.
Okay, cool. So we have this old Redmine website, which is, you know, it hasn't aged very well, and we've been meaning to replace it for a long time. So we sort of mentioned this in the last developers call. The plan forward is that we're sort of taking the front facing website, you know, just having it professionally designed, etc. And, that'll cover all sort of community related stuff, all the stories and applications, blogs, that kind of thing. And then the actual technical content, which used to be hosted by Redminer, that includes everything from sort of Git management, issues, feature requests. We'll have sort of a system in place for sort of improvement plans, like pips, we're going to call them gripes. And this will all be handled by GitLab. And I have a screenshot of the website in one of the upcoming slides.
My laptop is completely unresponsive.
Okay, I'm gonna forget stuff. I'm just gonna keep going until that unfreezes. So Neil already mentioned that GRCon 16 is happening. We actually talked about that last time, even when I did the last update here. We already had the dates announced and everything, but now the registration is open and you can buy tickets, and a lot of people have already bought tickets, so if you know that you're going, I would definitely recommend getting your ticket before we run out of space, which, you know, might not happen, but it could, and that would be fantastic. So the GRCon 2016 is going to be in Boulder, and the exact dates are September 12th to 18th or something. Yeah.
What?
12 to 16. Starting September 12th.
Hey.
Okay, what else? Did I forget something? Oh yeah, actually, yeah, no. Two things I forgot to mention. So we're actually working on making a GNU Radio Foundation. This is also part of the whole reorganization. That would maybe affect you if you're sort of like heavily involved with Canoe Radio. So, for example, the Canoe Radio Foundation will be the entity that is organizing GRCon 2016. And the project leads will then be the board of directors of that foundation. I already talked about the website. Working groups, we're sort of going to try and refocus. And for some of the working groups, we actually need new working group leaders. And Canoe Radio now has Slack integration. And there's been a lot of discussion of whether or not that's necessary or not, but some people like it. You go to slack.canoeradio.org and you can just sign up, and then you have all the Giphys on your phone, etc. Of course, IRC still works. We're not taking that away. There's really nothing that's happening on Slack that's not also happening on IRC. So unless you're sort of involved in one of the subgroups that have their own channels on Slack, you don't need to go there. But if you like that kind of thing, then yeah, I guess. And I'm not going to say what my opinion. Okay, no, it's great. Okay, next slide. Is it still loading? Slide. It's weird. Maybe charades, like the white noise and stuff like that. I don't know how to do that.
CPU load was pegged high. I don't know what was going on.
Okay.
I quit Safari.
I'm just going to keep talking about stuff that I think is on the next slide. So, website. So, Canoe Radio Conference, yes. So, a couple of things about the conference. Yeah, I already mentioned you do want to register if you already know you're going. So, the conference registration is. Okay, this is what the website looks like.
Skip that. This is
great. Yeah, there we go. You go to GnuRadio.org, it'll give you all the information, including a link to the registration. It's hosted by the University of Colorado in Boulder, I also mentioned that, which is close to NIST, for example, and other places that we're going to maybe use. So there's a place, I think it's called the Glenn Miller Ballroom, is where the actual conference will be happening. Yeah, so I was going to mention this, $350, which is pretty good value for money. It's not the cheapest conference I've ever been, but cheapest conference I've ever been to was Canoe Radio Conference 2012 or 2011. But I think it's still very good value for money. But if you're a student, then you don't even pay this. And you actually get free registration, which is sponsored by EDIS. And there's some rules. You have to sort of prove you're actually a student, but we don't sort of discriminate by anything else. So any kind of student enrollment proof will be fine. So, obviously, you still have to show up, so you have to still get to Boulder, but say maybe we have people in Boulder and pound Cyberspectrum, I don't know, come, it's a great conference, I don't know, Paul was there last time, maybe you like it.
It's great.
See?
Yeah.
There you go. Nothing else I can add at this point. So we also have a new users day, which is on the Monday, so the 12th, was it the 11th? Yeah. Which day is the Monday?
12th.
Okay. Yeah. So the new users day is separate, so you can go to both the new users day and the full conference. Usually you don't need to do that. Of course, you know, like maybe you're just super interested in everything, so please do. There might be some overlap in talks, but the new users day is specifically targeted to new users, hence the name, whereas the full conference is, you know, actual technical discussions, etc. So if you want to go to the new users day, there's a separate registration for that, but if you want to go to both, then you have to register for both. And then once again, like if you're a student, you can register for both and it's still free. I don't actually know what the price tag is though for the news there off the top of my head. Might be, I don't know, maybe 100 or something.
Yeah, it's 100.
Okay, cool. Okay, Canoe Radio Conference, any questions on that? Like,
question for speaker.
Yeah, from.
Is that free for all students, including other universities, or only University of Colorado Boulder?
No, any university. Doesn't have to be US, any university.
I'm just going to try to make. Story to mine.
Okay. Do you need me to say something while doing that?
No, just continue.
Okay. Yep. Does that answer? I guess that answers.
Doesn't work.
Are there any other questions? Maybe from Eric.
What about?
Thanks. Oh yeah. Free. Any questions?
All students anyway.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Cool. So, Canoe Radio Conference. Be there. It's awesome. Okay, we have a GNU Radio developer call tomorrow, and we have these every month. There's nothing special about this one. I just wanted to remind everyone that these are, you know, sort of public discussions of what's going on in the project. If you live in this area, it's 10 a.m. Pacific time, and we do it on Hangouts. So this is, you know, the people that actually speak, like there's me, for example, and I think that's Chris. Is that right? But you don't have to log into the Hangouts. You can just watch this, the live stream, and then listen to what's going on. And like Cyberspectrum, you can also post questions and stuff into IRC, and you know that's a way to participate if you don't want to join the actual Hangout. Do you have a question?
Are you hopefully going to continue to offer the GNU Radio Live ISO image going forward?
Oh yeah. So we have a slide on releases, so I'm going to mention it there. Yeah, GNU Radio Dev Call. So tomorrow we'll be talking about GRCon, some GSOC, stuff like that, release planning, that kind of thing. Okay? It's usually less than an hour, but as I mentioned, you don't actually have to actively participate, you just tune in and then listen to what's going on, and you'll be up to date to what's happening in the radio world. Next slide, please. Oh, we have a question.
How do we find that? How do we find a link to that?
So it's on the wiki page. The live stream has a different link every month, and it's auto created by YouTube. So we don't know what the link is until we start. I mean, we could probably ask Baden how he does it, and then be much smarter about this. But usually, what I do is I just post the link in IRC, and sometimes on the mailing list if I remember, and then you just click that.
Can you post it in Slack as well?
I automatically post it in Slack thanks to our awesome IRC Slack gateway. Okay, so Google Summer of Code is happening again. So if anyone doesn't know what this program is, it's a program where Google sponsors free software projects to pay students to work on, you know, the actual project. So in this case, Google is giving out stipends to, can't say the number, a number of students that will work on GNU Radio over the summer. And it's pretty nice. I think it's $5,500 per student. Assuming they actually pass both the midterms and the finals, which is graded by us. I can't really say all that much because the whole selection is not yet final. But last year we weren't accepted into the program, we were a bit sloppy with our application, and this year we spent a lot of time and effort to make sure we do get accepted, and it has worked. We are now part of the program again, and students have applied, and I think we have some great projects coming. And there is actually a similar program called the Summer of Code in Space, which is hosted by the European Space Agency, ESA, where we've also applied. We haven't heard back from them yet, but I'm very, very optimistic. So, because we've been doing this for a couple of years now, we have a whole group of mentors that help us doing that. So, you know, we're getting good at this kind of thing now. And I'd like to thank all the mentors for their time, you know, help, you know, reading and grading proposals, but then obviously also mentoring over the summer. Yeah, so GSOC and SOCIS, so the Summer of Code in Space, both happening, and I don't know if there's any questions regarding those specific items. Okay, next slide, please. And yes, so we have a radio release coming up. Nothing super exciting, I actually just went through the release logs just before the for the Cyberspectrum, and it's mostly bug fixes. 3792 is now the most up-to-date image, and there will be an ISO for the DVD. Is it already released? Okay. So, yeah, it was already released. You can torrent it or directly download it. Same as usual. We will not stop doing that. And I think some guy has actually built a Windows installer for 3792, including UHD 393. It's a one-click installer thing, so... you know, installing stuff with Windows is awkward, but this guy, Jeff something, has volunteered to help us with that, and from what I've heard, it's actually pretty solid. So you install it and you can do stuff. I don't know how difficult it is to develop out of tree modules on your local system against that, so maybe you're just limited to GRC, which is already very, very, very powerful. Maybe Hans Cyberspectrum has some notes on that. Yeah, and as I said, I mentioned before, Nathan West is now the release manager for GNU Radio, and he also releases Folk. So Folk 1.2.2 is also the official Folk version for 3.7.9. So Folk is the vector optimized library of kernels, which is also used by other projects outside of GNU Radio. Okay, that's GNU Radio. I think there's at least two more slides. Yeah, this is actually completely unrelated to USDR, but Ubuntu 16.04 is coming out, and Ubuntu is still probably the most popular distribution among GNU Radio hackers. So I just wanted to point this out. I haven't really tested it. I know people have, and I think it works, but there's some Spectral TEs here, so it'll ship with GCC 6 and Python 3 by default. Okay, I thought someone said something. So we already know that.
That was you.
Oh, I said something. Boo. I'm meta. We already know that GNU Radio doesn't work with Python 3, so I'm really not looking forward to that. So I know that you can install Python 2, but I guess it'll be awkward, difficult. No, it'll be awesome. For us it'll be fairly easy, but on the mailing list it'll.
I just mean it's one other step, but there you have to manually install Python 2 if it's just an apt-get install.
I just realized that PyBOMs doesn't do that though. So if you do PyBOMs install GNU Radio on Ubuntu 16.04, it's going to break.
Yeah, right.
It's a good thing I think about these things while I'm actually doing my presentation. So yeah, so something will break. I was actually fairly optimistic when I started speaking about this. Okay, I have another small announcement, which is UHD has also a couple of releases, so I happen to manage those, so I happen to know that. And I apologize to other SCR projects for not mentioning their driver releases, but I just didn't have the time to grow all of them. But we have one more release since last Cyberspectrum, but we're actually having another one within the next week or so, which is fairly important for those people who are doing full duplex on USERPs. Please update your 3.9.4 once it gets released. And the master branch has dual 200 meg samples received now, thanks to Paul, and he'll be actually talking about that in great detail. So people who've been tracking our master branch will notice they're getting further and further apart. Made a master, we're adding lots and lots of features, so you can look forward to a 3.10 release later this year, which will be a big change. Okay, that's my last slide. So maybe people want to use the opportunity to query me on stuff. Doesn't seem to. Yeah. Oh, there's a question.
Is there a plan to move to Python 3 at some point?
Yes, there is. And it's actually a very specific plan. It's not just, yes, we want to do it. We actually also know how we want to do it. You're talking about GNU Radio, that is, right?
Yeah.
So GNU Radio has some very, very entrenched dependencies. One of them is Cheetah. And Cheetah is no longer developed. So it's just always going to be Python 2 only. And the plan is to switch our template library on to one called Mako, which we already use elsewhere. Now, the problem here is that any GRC file, and that doesn't only include our files, it includes any file that anyone ever wrote in their own tree modules, can include Cheetah snippets. There's nothing, like, it's perfectly legal. That's how we handle dynamic templates. So all of those are going to break. But we don't have any plan B. No one ever forked Cheetah and made a Python 3 compatible version of it. Also, it's not a very good template engine. Like, it was nice in the early 2000s, but it's not really, it hasn't aged well. So changing that out makes a lot of sense, except for the fact that it will break everything. And for those who've been around for a long time and remember the 3.7 API change, it was a huge pain to deal with. And it'll be less tough, but it'll still be very annoying. Also, someone needs to actually step up and do all the GRC changes. Now, we have the GRC working group manager, Sebastian, who's extremely good about these things, but he's just one guy and he can only do so much stuff. So we have a plan, we know how to do it, we just lack the manpower to do it right now. And obviously we can't do it on the 3.7 release cycle because it's too big of a change.
You said it'll break everyone's GRC files. You mean every block definition, right? Not every flow graph that's been built in GRC, because those are the Canadian templates, right?
Yes, that is correct. So I'm talking about the GRC bindings. So the .xml file that you have in your auto-tree module. If you have a, you know what those files look like, right? They're a bunch of XML, but in between those tags, you can put in cheetah or Python code.
Yes, what I'm saying is people who just build Flowgraphs in GRC are not going to be trying to stop broken.
That is correct.
Any .grc file is fine.
So that is correct, unless they're using auto-tree modules where the author is not aware of those changes. Because then the auto-tree module will be broken from GRC's perspective. So if you just use Python or C++ to build your flow graphs, which few people do these days, then you wouldn't even notice this change. But, I don't know, like, what's a good example? GRSpecX, for example, hasn't been updated in a long time, and then it might not get updated ASAP, and it'll just not work. So if your flow graph includes, like, a GRSpecX block, then it's not going to work. Maybe. Depends on the block. Tom?
Can you comment on the state of Qt5?
Oh yeah, I can actually. So, for those who track the GNU Radio repositories, we have the next branch, which is for the 3.8, and this for the 3.8 release, whenever that will be. And this time we actually have two branches for next. We have next and next Qt5, and that's where the Qt5 development is happening. So we're sort of aware that we sort of need to do the transition. And people started getting involved and testing, etc. And hopefully we can merge those branches before we do anything, like do any major releases. And then the next major release will just be Qt5. So I'm not the guy who's most intimate with that development. So asking and pound GNU Radio might actually give us an answer right now.
Who is that?
Jay Corgan, maybe. Or, yeah, Jay Corgan.
He's most intimate with.
I don't know, but he's the release manager, so he's the chief architect, so he would be able to give that answer. But there is development happening, and it's looking good. So, people usually ask about the Qt port of GRC, and it's happening at some point, but it's a lot of work. Okay. Anything else from Pound Cyberspectrum?
No, nothing there.
Fantastic. Okay, well then that was it. Thank you very much. I'm going to do this on a regular basis. So that if you have things that you think I should talk about, then please let me know on Twitter or my email, wherever, or in IRC or in Slack, and I'll be very happy to include those for next time I do this news blog. Okay, thank you everyone.
Thank you, Martin.
Hi, I'm Kevin Reed, author of Shiny SDR, and spoken a couple times here before. So this time I have an actually original piece of DSP to show you. At least I think it's original. I think it's the first thing I invented that's actually original. But it's a very simple trick. Okay, so. So, in software-defined radio, we have a well-established way of visually representing the signals in the entire bandwidth supported by your hardware. Waterfall display, where you have your frequency across and your power or your time vertically. So what I'm going to talk about is a way to represent that entire bandwidth as audio. So you can see here a piece of the band. Let's turn up that gain a bit. So you can see here a piece of the band assigned to aeronautical use, as the FCC would have it. Most of what we can pick up is aircraft in flight talking to air traffic control. And the thing about this is that there are a lot of different frequencies for different purposes. So if you were trying, say, to hear just what's in your local area, you'd have to monitor a lot of them. So you see, there's one, there's a couple more. Want to try to tune around and catch some of those? Of course, we've always had scanners, but even good scanners will miss the beginnings of transmissions, and if you're trying to do scanning in software that isn't real-time, baked into your radio firmware or whatever, you're going to have high latency, which means slow scanning and missing even more. But I heard about a neat trick for this particular application in hardware radio, not the topic at night. So you simply build an AM receiver with bad selectivity. Now, selectivity, or the lack of it, means that it tends to pick up any signal in a wide band. In the early days of radio, this was hard because we hadn't figured out good filters or the super heterodyne architecture, and so on. So lack of selectivity is bad if you have lots of simultaneous signals. So selectivity was good when you were trying to listen to your broadcast radio where you got all these channels right next to each other. At least that's the situation. But it's good if you have a situation with intermittent signals like we see here. So this is a conventional AM demodulator, SDR AM demodulator, with some details left out. You do your usual channel selection. You shift the frequency, filter out just that one channel, decimate it. Then you do your demodulation, which is just taking the magnitude, and then you have there's your audio signal with a DC offset, which you can just get rid of. So all we need to do to make it unselective is to swap the stages. We take the RF straight from the hardware and demodulate it like it's one big AM signal. Then we filter it, but not because we're trying to select anything, but because we want an audio frequency, audio sample rate, output signal. That's it. This works. In fact, it works really well. You might think this is just a recipe for listening to lots of noise, but it's actually very quiet in the absence of a signal. The reason is because most of the output of the demodulator step is at much higher than audio frequency. The only signals that pass the filter are the ones that have something that looks like AM. You've got a carrier, and you've got a sideband that's close to it, within an audio frequency distance from each other. Of course, many signals aren't AM, and in fact, if there's no amplitude variation in some signal, then it just appears as silence. In fact, a reduction in the amount of noise you receive. But there's a lot of signals that have some amplitude variation, and I'll talk further about this issue after the demo. So, I have one final refinement, the spatial part of this, which is why I've called this the audible waterfall. We want to be able to better discriminate between multiple signals coming in simultaneously, and the obvious way to do that is stereo. So this is just as simple to implement as the rest. All you do is apply a filter which has a gradual ramp of gain versus frequency across the entire spectrum. You feed that to one channel, and then you do the exact opposite for the other channel. So the signals that are closer to the lower end of the frequency band are stronger on the left and weaker on the right, and vice versa. That's it. See. Oh, and to keep the levels in the proper balance, you want to do your AGC over here, not later. That's okay. So now, enough talking about it, let's show it off. Unfortunately, it looks like the planes have mostly landed. We got our basic AM modulator. We pick up some. Oh, there's somebody. He's a little weak. Anyway, so let's go into the new mode. So now we're racking our bandwidth as the entire signal. And let's see if we can tune around a bit. Gotta do this. Unfortunately, this is going to be a little glitchy because this is actually connecting from my server at home, so I'm limited on the bandwidth. And let's see. Yay. Excellent demo.
It's far better place.
Ah, there we go. Just a little glitch. So let's see if we can find something. Okay. So, unfortunately, this is a better demo if everybody here had headphones. But if you listen to it, you should be able to see, you know, the stuff that's over here. That's on the right side. And stuff that's over here is on the left side. Let me just tune some more. Okay, that's Moffett Field, which is very close to where I live. You can see he's on the right. Now he's on the left. Are supposed to be on the left?
It's moving back and forth.
Okay. Yeah. So, you can see, it works. Okay, of course.
Can you do me a favor and apologize to the people online? Because they're only receiving this in mono.
Ah, okay. I'm informed that the stereo part is not working properly. Actually, in fact, I bet
we only have a mono output.
Okay. Yeah. So I'm informed that the recording and streaming is only being in mono. So that does kind of put a damper on the things because can I say you put this thing on with headphones, you're really hearing the spectrum, you know? So. And now, on the other hand, like I said, this is by itself just an AM receiver, but it turns out that a lot of signals out there are still they've still got some some AM to them. Like this guy here, that's an amateur radio repeater. It's supposed to be FM. It's got you can't really hear the audio, but you can hear some noise. So it's telling you that there's a signal there, and I think that's interesting. Now, and then we can do other things like, let's see, so let's go to 433, so you can see, we've got a bunch of ISM type stuff, and you can hear it's there. We're using a low rate FFT, so you can't see it's there, but you can hear it's there. You hear the pops, and you can hear tell frequency that are out by fan if that's working. Now,
did you turn up the volume so we can hear the pops?
Oh, yeah. Okay. And you could hear exactly the same thing with an AM receiver if you were tuned right on. But this thing, this is like I said, the goal of this is to put the entire spectrum in your ears. Okay, now let's turn.
That's really, really cool.
Yeah, now let's turn this off and switch to the demo, which will run better because it is local. This is running from this antenna right here. And you know what that means. So. Okay, so here's something that's local. You can see. You can see it and you can hear it. And it's across the spectrum and now it's. And since we're local, we're not bandwidth limited, so let's also crank up the rate. And there you go.
So we're looking at LTE uplink?
I frankly don't know what this is.
It's a good
beat.
Yeah.
So call it an art project. Yeah. Oh, and one unfortunate thing is I'm running this on the HackRF1, which has a DC offset, a big spike in the middle. So that does unfortunately mean that it basically weakens everything else. It appears as silence.
I have a question for you.
Yeah.
What if two similarly strong signals are occurring at the same time?
If they are within the bandwidth of the audio filter and your ears, then you will hear them. You will hear a tone due to that. So let me see if I can find some garbage to.
What if you just tune to the AM band? Yeah. Oh, you can't do that on the hacker app.
Sure, I can't. Well, remember, this is still an AM receiver. Okay, so let me switch over to the remote. Let's see. So if I go over to my home system, which has all the bands, and turn the gain down again, and if we turn the gain all the way down and visit the AM band and tune in here. Sorry about that. Okay. So if we turn it, you can put it in this mode, then actually what happens is you just get the strongest station. Just like this is, just like for classic radio, you know, it, the strongest station wins because its carrier is, you know, I haven't actually put the math to this to say exactly what signals are going to get through, but that's the effect that you get. The strongest carrier wins. And, you know, or that's what I've observed in practice. So, let's see. So, there is a, and let me, let's see. So, okay, how am I doing on time? Okay, so there, I'll just cover a couple points. There is a notable defect in this principle of just applying a filter, because if you've ever heard of something called slope detection, you know what I'm about to say. That because frequencies in DSP are always, you know, on a circle. That is, we have this frequency is exactly equal to this frequency, and if you keep going up, you come back to the front. And we use bandpass filters to hide that. But so as a result, my filter slopes across the spectrum has to go up, back up really fast at the other side. It's really a sawtooth curve. And so that means that if you have some, signal, okay, I need to do this demo on the other one. So that means that if you have some signal which is at the end of the spectrum, what did I do? So if we put it in this the mode, I do apologize for the way it does that. I need to work on the truth. Okay. So we're listening to weather radio, which weather radio is FM. So of course you shouldn't be hearing it, but you do a little bit. Now that's in this case it's mostly because the transmitter is imperfect. But if we adjust the tuning so that it's just at the edge. Come on, you can see, actually it's not working, but in many cases you'll hear the signal better this way because it's riding the slope of the filter and that causes an amplitude variation and therefore that causes something that demodulates.
You had it earlier when you were testing it out, right?
Yeah.
Do you think you just need to adjust the frequency a little bit more? Is it? It was working quite well when I heard it before.
This is just quirks. Okay, so the final bit of my prepared talk is directions for future research. This is things that would be interesting to expand this thing to do. And the first one is, of course, can we make it detect FM and so on? Now, if you naively try to make a unselective FM demodulator, then of course, what you get is a horrible noise because the way FM works is it's looking for the frequency peak that's moving across, and if it's moving too far, such as if it's just receiving noise really, then what you get is horrible noise because as far as the demodulator is concerned, it's seeing a signal that's repeatedly slamming back and forth and clipping on where it's the audio level because frequency translates in amplitude. So I haven't figured out a good way to do it with FM. But what I'd really like to do is figure out some way to make it work so that it will just generate tones for unmodulated carriers or modulated carriers, but we don't care what the modulation is. And, so basically the same sort of thing that you use for receiving Morse code. In where we do that, you basically take the input signal and you mix it down to an audio frequency. But of course, that depends on knowing exactly what That depends on knowing exactly what the input frequency is to pick an audio frequency, you know, neighbor of it. Somebody remind me where GSM is?
800,
944, but not the US
stuff, right? I forget
which
is the
band. Yeah, 850. I had this in the, let's see. No, actually, this does make a good demo. Let me see. I've got it in the database.
You find the most like around the internet,
like 98. There we go. Let's see.
That's a good point. Try in the
This was okay. This was working.
Kevin?
Yeah.
Can you go up to 1900? Let's see. 1800, 1900?
A little higher.
Higher.
Keep on going. Like, upper part of 1900.
Hackraft was nicely responsive, I'll have to say. Oh, yes, and this being an unselective AM modulator, it is, of course, great for picking up noise. Okay.
Oh, what was that?
Oh, something. Now, that's too... Okay, why are we... Now, why does it think that there's no audio? Something's just a... Oh, I see. It's that guy being able to see modulator version. No? Sorry. Okay, I know if we use one of the provisions I built in recently, which is the reboot the server option. I'm not sure what I did wrong here. Ah, I see. This is a really strong peak, so it's just basically causing there to be silence. No? So, because... So that's why there's no sound. So like I said, you know, a really strong carrier is quieter than nothing. Okay, anyway, so what I'd really like to do is to be able to pick up those unmodulated carriers I tried the first thing that came to mind was to mix the signal with a copy of itself so you get the sight, but that just adds a constant tone to everything. Yeah. So I suspect that it's just impossible to do that, but if it were, it would be interesting. And, you know, one thing I have heard is a similar trick being done in single sideband receivers, which are, again, you know, just mix the RF down to baseband and treat that as audio, which is to say, you have just an audio band with a passband, but to do the same kind of slope filtering on that, so what happens is, if you have a carrier in that passband, you always get the pitch varying, but you also get the stereo pan varying. I've heard good things about that. But that's a different system, and it doesn't give you this, you know, okay, let's listen to 10 megahertz at once. Okay, I am out of things to say. Does anyone want me to tune anywhere interesting?
I do have a question from the internet, though.
Okay.
It says, I would like to try this locally. Is the code online?
Yes, it is. Install Shiny SDR. This
is... Show us the webpage?
Yeah, let's see. Unfortunately, ShinySDR does not have a website yet. It's on GitHub. So there you go. Paper.shinySDR.
Can you increase the font?
So there you go. You know, obvious URL on GitHub. And so you just fire it up, click the AM unselected button, and it'll work. Of course, the hard part there is actually the first part, namely installing ShinySDR, because I haven't really cleaned it up and packaged it up nice, because it's a Python program, it depends on the new radio, it depends on some other stuff, but for the most part, it's install GNU radio, then do a regular Python install, and it'll work. But there's a few caveats, the documentation tells you how to install it. You can actually read the documentation.
How are you accessing your SDR at home?
Over the internet. ShinySDR is a web-based client-server system. The server side runs all the new radio stuff. The client side does all of the user interface. And so this is a web page. That's it. In fact, you know, even the waterfall rendering is in a web page.
Other question. Are you good signal processing for that in Korea, or is it done in Chinese in Python?
The signal processing is all made up of GNU radio blocks.
So my question is, can I make a GRC program that
basically... Yeah, you can absolutely do this in GRC. Said, just make this. It works. The one thing you will have to do is you'll have to borrow my code for constructing this filter filter, but that's just... Yeah, it's just... I just asked somebody, how do I make a custom filter like this? And they said, do this. And I wrote the Python code for it. But you could just copy the tabs out.
I mean, I guess my question was, is there a GRC program?
But this is literally just, like I said at the beginning, this is literally just, you take your standard AMD modulator block, you swap things around, and of course make sure the sample rates are correct, but you have to do that for everything.
I'm too dumb for GNU radio. Can you just give me the GRC?
I believe the standard answer is, here are my rates. But no, it's, if someone has trouble implementing this, let me, I'll probably be convinced to explain, to demonstrate, but, it rarely is, follow the, the one difference that will trip you up if you just try to shuffle things around in the radio is that in an ordinary demodulator, the filter, which is converting from the RF sample rate and bandwidth to the audio filter rate and bandwidth, in an ordinary modulator, because this is coming here at the IQ stage, this will be a complex-to-complex filter. Because it is now after the demodulation here, this will be a float-to-float filter. And of course, it will, but other than that, it still needs to downsample at the same rates, and the demodulator block is completely unchanged because sort of this has no parameters whatsoever. But it really is, that's all there is to it.
Another question, can you tune into LTE and see how it sounds?
Give me a number.
751.
751? This is the home one. Let's try my home station is all built on RTLSDR, so it has less bandwidth. Let's try. Okay, there we go. So, there you go. That's the internet in your ears. Oh, fun. Let's try it again. Just a little connectivity problem. Connectivity to local host. Software is hard.
Wi-Fi.
Yeah. There's some packets. Let's turn off the VM.
Cool. Yeah, thanks, Kevin.
Now for comparison, you're just using a regular AM receiver, it just sounds like this. Because this is picking up, just one little slice of it. But in this mode, we're collecting, we're basically, getting all that stuff which is correlated across the entire input spectrum, and that's you're picking up. So you can pick up these, so you can get some audible information about the structure of these wide band signals. Of course, we would even neater if this fit in the bandwidth of the receiver, but.
It looks like your software has changed quite a bit since I last saw you presenting.
Yeah. Let me turn it. Yeah, I'm sure anybody who's listening to the stream over headphones is a little bothered by my level of volume controls, Okay, so you want me to talk about what I've done in Shiny SDR?
Yeah.
Okay, a lot of it is just sort of UI tweaks, but like things like, okay, so like in the frequency database here, basically there's two things that's changed. One is it's now listing bands in the table. Okay, that's trivial. You know? The other is I put in more canned data. So I recently just finished transcribing the US frequency allocation chart, so it'll actually just, so it'll tell you where you are. And that's actually a big part of my mission, because the idea of Shiny SDR is partly to be a tool that, you know, once you've got it up and running, it really helps you explore the spectrum. And I see the built-in frequency databases as being part of that. Like, you know, it knows where weather radio is, it knows where AM is, it knows where GSM is. Well, actually, I don't think that one's in the database yet. But it can jump over to CB or FRS or whatever, you know, or just, you know, and it knows what modes to use for them. So the mode selection's all hairy. You need the right rules. Is it supposed to switch, et cetera. And mostly, I have been doing a lot of just sort of little polishing things, and there's still some fundamental issues. The one that's really weighing on me right now is I want to make it multi-user, but that requires changing the internal architecture, like, for example, to have separate audio buses for each user so they can listen separately. And I've just been sort of mostly thinking about how to fix that, but... And, you know, but there's other, you know, if you're just looking at it and how it changed, then it's just mostly things like I rearranged how the UI works, so, you know, like, well, that's a little silly, but it's got, you know, it's got a hamburger menu now. And so, just, it improves the layout a lot when you're on a small screen.
Great, thank you. Hey, just one more thing. Can you go to 9:15?
Sure.
I don't know how much we'll get around here. Should be a lot of frequency hopping stuff in this ISM band.
Yeah.
Doesn't look like we're getting much. Can you try your one at home?
Let's see. Okay, yeah, I can do that. Let's see. Actually, okay, for this one, for that frequency, I can use my UHF. And so let's see. Yeah, there's something. Unfortunately, it's not detectively hopping around, but, yeah.
Yeah, you do this in the middle of a big city or something, and we'll be...
But, yeah, there's something. Actually, I think I've often seen something, so let's see.
Is there actually FHSS in 900, or is that more TSSS?
Yeah, there we go. There's some more a little lower.
I mean, I put interesting restrictions on the amount of time you can be on A, depending upon how many channels you're on.
Yeah. But it is, you know, you can hear a lot there. You're not seeing it because I can't use the high rate FFT over the internet. It's out there.
All right, great. Thanks again, Kevin.
Basically, what I'm going to show is the dual 10 gig Ethernet working. So this is a total. This is 200 megasamples per second for each, and so a total of 400 megasamples per second. And so this allows you to use both interfaces at the same time with the same UHC source in GNU Radio. And so the way you take advantage of this is you should be tracking master, and you should be able to pull these changes in. And you can specify a primary address and a secondary address with adder and the second adder. And then you should also specify the type X300. And so this lets you immediately start using this. You might also want to play with the number of receive frames, because we're talking about really fast rates, so you can still run into those. So you do need a pretty fast computer analyst, as well as a good which we recommend several types. So I will go ahead and demonstrate this working. All right, so the first thing I'm going to show is two QT frequency sinks at 1536. So that's a maximum GNU radio will allow me to actually set. And the rate is actually half, or the period is actually half the default, so 0.05, I guess.
Okay.
So here's the thing running. I've got two separate FFTs running here. One's at the centered at 0.4 or 2.4 gigahertz. The other one's centered at 840 megahertz. So you can kind of see what's going on there. And that's actually, it's running fine. There's no O's, no D's. That's a total of 400 mega samples per second coming into two separate FFTs. It's pretty amazing. It's a lot of data.
Can you show us HTOP?
Yes. So we can see the core utilization there. We should see like one thread tank pretty high. I don't know if you guys can see that at all. The load's being distributed pretty well. And so that's the main contribution of the changes that we made. There was one thread that was being pegged pretty high with, that was also making the receive calls, socket receive calls. So we placed that on a separate thread called a zero copy receive offload. And that's really what helped us get this sort of performance where we're not seeing O's or D's or the sort. So basically moving those calls off the main thread really helped. main change. I'll also show you the waterfall is working. Just to say it is. So I think this is the default update rate for the waterfall plot in GNU Radio, but it's a lot of bandwidth. And no O's, no D's, and we are making heavy utilization of our CPU. So yeah, that's sort of the main contribution of these changes we recently made. If you want to use dual 10 gig Ethernet on your X310 or X300, be sure to build master.
So what were the changes, essentially?
So basically, it was the changes were creating a separate transport that copies the pointers to pointers to the buffers, basically, to another. So basically, we have one thread that makes the receive calls, and then it, as quickly as it can, puts the pointers to the buffers that's calling the receive calls on into a queue, and then the main thread is basically pulling from that queue. So basically, we have one thread that's trying to call these, make these receive calls as fast as possible, and if the main thread is overloaded, it doesn't have any. It'll have issues making those kernel calls at the same time as it's doing other stuff. So this offload reduces the burden on the main thread.
And it's zero copy, so that it's passing pointers around to one buffer memory.
Right.
Can you talk a bit about 10 gigabit bits,
Yes. So there is some tuning that you will have to do for the NIC itself. In this case, this is an Intel NIC. So it defaults, at least on Fedora, to 256 on the number of RX descriptors. So I had to increase that to 4096. And if you don't, what you see is these every now and then pop up. And that's just the socket buffers getting full. But it's all, that's also a good sign, because that tells you that you're not, your system's not exploding. Like, if you got a run of these, you would be, that would be an indicator that you're getting open wrong. So, yeah. So you do have to play with that, and there are notes and documentation that were included that tell you basically how to use ETH tool to make those changes. So, yeah, the defaults are usually on the conservative side. So if you're having problems, check your NIC.
Do you want to show us the spectrum again?
Oh, yes. I was just staring at each dot thing. Yeah, so I can actually move this around.
Show us a, give us a smile or a wave or a point or something. again, so on, wait. There we go.
Yeah, so, yeah, there's a lot of data. So that's all I've got.
Which NIC did you use, or did you test several NICs?
So, I tested this model is the 8,229.99, or 80,
it's an Intel.
Anyway, we recommend some NICs, like the X520, the X540, the X710, those are all good solid Intel NICs. This particular one, I don't think is on our list of recommendations, but it still works, so that's a good sign.
This is the one you're using now?
Yes.
Did you use Intel NIC specifically for their open source drivers?
No.
Much more pragmatic than it works.
It worked, yeah. So, yeah, I chose this NIC because it was the one in this machine that I tested with, and also it worked. But, yeah. Also, make sure you choose up-to-date drivers. That can make a difference.
Did you actually use the Intel drivers, or just the stock kernel driver?
So I installed the drivers.
Yeah.
When I, but I'm not sure that made a difference, but it probably could. I mean, the distance of your NIC to the CPU on the PCIe Express slot can make a difference. So, especially at the side of the rate.
So one reason these do work is because Intel always provides up to date drivers very well supported. So I guess it kind of factors in indirectly. Mm-hmm. And we've had other issues where the fact that Intel drivers expose all settings to the like kernel drivers helped us. So like with ETHtool you would change pretty much anything on the reason. Like I'm not sure that's true for other manufacturers that don't have quite up to date.
Right.
Can you repeat some?
Oh, yes. So you were saying another reason for the choice of Intel NICs is that you can make changes with ETHpool, and that may not be true for other cards.
The micro is a transmitter.
Is it
damning?
It's
infrared.
It's
blinking.
You can tell because if you look in there.
Can you repeat
the full
stuff?
Oh, yes. So one other reason for the choice of Intel NICs is basically you can make changes.
It's coming out there, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, is
it? Oh, I don't know. Go again.
All right. 1, 2, 3.
Yep. All right, it's working.
Okay. So, yes. So another reason for the choice of the Intel NICs is that you can make changes to like the number of descriptors with ETHtool, and that may not be true for for other other cards that are manufactured by other vendors. Okay, good. Yeah, so this is pretty big improvement, so that's all I got to say.
I have a question.
Oh, sure.
It has to be two waterfalls, it can't be just one giant one.
So you could do one giant one. I think that, I mean, the reason I chose this is because it's easy to fit on the screen. But, with the new radio. But, yeah, there's no reason, I mean, that would probably be easier on the computer, actually. Just do one giant waterfall. That way you don't have two separate threads in the overhead, two separate FFTs.
Load balances between the two.
No.
This is two separate data boards you're looking at right now, right?
Yes, this is two separate channels.
This is not a bonded network connection. It's two separate data codes
going down two separate paths.
Yes. Yes. There's time alignment though, because it is one UHD source. You could also use two separate UHD sources, and that would actually be even less of a load because you don't have the timer alignment.
Have you got phosphor on there?
I have not. So this computer doesn't have a GPU capable of really doing that justice. But if you do have a GPU that can do that, please try it out. So that would be awesome.
We can get the cube with the dual port Mellanox we put up by Thunderbolt. Because that'd be all night.
Right.
You want that? What are you doing with that?
No, the network buffers in there.
I'm betting a 5.
Betting what?
I'm betting a 5. I'm betting a 10.
Yeah, so take screenshots.
Alright, thank you. There's a question from the internet. They might not have heard it though. Can the two connections stream completely separate chunks of RF spectrum, or are they related?
They can. So they're unrelated because they're two separate channels. But yeah, you could stitch it together certainly.
But in terms of the logical strings, I mean, they map to each border board, right?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. So they're two separate channels. So if you put them side by side, you've got some overlap. And,
so that's more about the visual representation.
Right. Yeah. So.
All right. Any other questions? Okay. Thank you for that.
I've always been fascinated with radar, and I might need to resize some things here. Always been fascinated with radar, and a while back when I was playing around with the very first USERP I had, USERP 1, I took it out and set up the long wire and recorded some signals on HF. And if you're familiar with the work of Yuha, who's done some incredible radar applications, he used USERPs and radio waves to image the moon and do ionospheric sounding and ionospheric tomography and all sorts of amazing stuff. So I went back and I looked at these old HF recordings and I saw the ionosomes there. I thought, oh, I'll downconvert them and it looks, I mean, it's very, very rough results at this point. I don't know whether you can see this. So that's actually the webcam? Can you see that around the web? Because I'm not sharing my screen with the internet.
Yes.
So here, this is actually three different ionosomes, chirps in a 1 MHz worth spectrum. And so this is actually showing you the reflection on different layers in the ionosphere. These are just broadcast channels in the HF spectrum. But it's really neat because this technique is actually sounding what the state of the world is, or the ionosphere in this case. And you can see those reflections come back in time. Maybe another time I'll go through in detail how you actually arrive at that.
But I thought it'd be cool to maybe play around with and demonstrate quite simply, where are the cans? Can I have those cans? FMCW radar. So there are all the different sorts of radar systems out there, and one very, very popular one is FMCW frequency modulated carry wave. So you might recognize these cans from a previous Cyberspectrum. Julian Arnold, aka Broadcrack, built these cans, and he did a CW radar experiment out front. And people would drive up and down, reflect some of the RF energy of the carry wave, and as they would be traveling, they would induce a Doppler shift on the return signal. On an FFT, you could see the energy move from to the left and to the right of the main carrier. Now, I thought it would be kind of nice to reuse this and use a USERP, which has at least the B series has that chip that will do coherent receive, transmit, and you can use FMCW with this. Maybe if you hang around, I'll replace the blocks in that flow graph I showed you with the UHD source and sink. But I thought maybe there's a way to make an even simpler demo that doesn't actually even require SDR. So I'm going to do the unthinkable and show you something in GNU Radio that does not use an SDR, but still I think makes the point. Where's that flow graph? There it is. So this flow graph, I'll go through it in a little bit. But it is essentially a very simple implementation of what's funny?
It's simple.
I'll turn the disabled blocks off there. That's a little bit better, isn't it? It's a very simple FMCW radar flow graph. And I'll demonstrate it. And since it doesn't use radio, you might be able to guess what it actually does use. Any guesses? Speakers and microphone, that's right. So let's launch that. And if you hear that, that's the chirp that's going out. What I'm going to do is I'm going to change the height of that display because it doesn't quite fit on this display. Where are we?
Did you have to write any blocks?
No.
Wait, his using out of three blocks.
That's odd. I don't need that anymore. Window size. What is it? Width by height, right? Is that right? Still off the screen at the bottom. Any suggestions? Width, comma height. So, I don't know, 640? It's important to be able to see the bottom of this thing. There we go. So it sounds quite loud and obnoxious, but there is a chirp that's being sent from the speakers out into the world. This is actually running at a chirp rate of 50 hertz, so essentially it's scanning through the entire audio frequency range 50 times a second. I can slow it down and you can actually see what it looks like, but just imagine that you have a carry wave that you're changing the frequency of and you're moving it up through your spectrum, but you're doing that really quickly, 50 times a second. Now, I won't go into the details, maybe another time, but things like the chirp rate and the bandwidth over which you're actually sweeping your carry wave, they all have implications on the range that you can detect and the resolution that you can actually make those range measurements with. This is just some arbitrary values that I picked to actually demonstrate the effect. So, what's interesting here is that we can actually hear the chirp. When you would use this in an SDR, in a radio system, you're actually doing this exact thing, except it's in the RF domain using RF energy. Here we just happen to be moving molecules in the air around that's reaching our ears. So all that's happening here is that it's coming out of the left and right speakers, and also the microphone in the laptop is simultaneously receiving the audio that it hears. So it's going to hear itself, but what's nice about FMCW is you can hear yourself, that's all right. What you're interested in is what comes a little later in time. So fundamentally, what you should think about is, as you have this chirp that's running across your frequency spectrum, your bandwidth, what you're interested in are reflections. That's what radar is all about, right? Looking for some reflected energy. In this case, we're looking for reflected acoustics. But as with anything, there's propagation delay. So there's radio waves of audio that will come out, hit an object, and then some of that energy will bounce back. That takes time. But if you think about the chirp, from the point of view of the transmitter, you're going to be chirping up, that signal is going to bounce out and come back. So when it comes back to you, you'll get some of the chirp coming back, but it'll be delayed in time. So what you can do then is when you down-convert it, you'll get this incredibly strong, this is obviously, you know, a waterfall, and what you have to imagine is that this is time going up as it's sampling each chirp. So each of these lines is essentially the down conversion of one chirp. But then what we see here in the horizontal axis is actually range information. So you have intensity where you actually have some sort of a response coming back. Question?
Clarification, when you say down conversion, you mean you're down converting it from the chirp frequency.
The chirp.
Which is so what we're seeing is not stitching it right, it's actually shifting it down to the which varies with that same chirp.
Yeah, right. So what's actually happening is the microphone is receiving the sample and coming back, and then we take that and we multiply it by this chirp again, or the conjugate of it rather. And what that does is it actually turns, instead of being a chirp now in the frequency domain, it turns it into just a single tone. And that single tone is what we originally transmitted, and anything that comes after that in time actually gets converted into the frequency domain. So this chirp down conversion is really neat because it takes anything that originally you received in time, and then you can visualize it using an FFT because you actually turn it into this, you do a domain transformation into the frequency domain. It's really, really cool. So all that's happening here is this here, it's hearing what we're sending. So the interesting thing is, let's give it something to reflect off. So let me grab, say, my pizza plate. You know what, for the benefit of people out there, I'm going to actually set up the hangout, because I think it will look better. Excuse me while I set the call here. That work? Okay, I'm screen sharing. Does that come on?
Yeah, came on.
All right. And then we can switch. Alright, so we've got a view of everything, I think. So obviously if I turn the volume down on my output, then everything disappears. The microphone's selective, and as I'm talking, you can see energy appearing there on this this waterfall. This is obviously false information, because it really should only be expecting signals such as the reflection of the original chirp, but there's other spurious interference in energy, and so when it gets down-converted, you end up with that sort of crud. But we can ignore that for the purpose of this demonstration. I'm going to turn the volume up so we get some good range. It's probably a little bit high, actually. Now, just bear in mind that this is a really, really crude setup. You've got, speakers that aren't particularly fantastic over the entire range in the laptop, and then the microphone is actually in the left speaker in the laptop, and it's picking up all of this signal, too. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to get the plate. Presumably, the wavefront is mainly coming out from the laptop. Oh, well, look,
yeah,
there you go.
Never mind the plate.
I don't need the plate then. But as you can see here, as I lift the plate up, then essentially you have a nice little radar cross section.
What are your units on the x-axis?
So this plot is actually a modification of the original plot. Essentially, you just give it a vector of information. So here, visually, displayed is just every point. It's a 512-point transform that's happening. But it's actually range information.
So it bends, and you can convert to range.
Yeah, right. So, I mean, the way you do that is you have your sample rate, you can calculate how many samples per chirp you have,
right,
and then you can determine that from there. So, you can, considering it's just audio, and it's just coming out from the laptop, I was surprised at how well it worked. I thought, I'll put together a little flow graph and prep that for use with the cans. But then I thought, well, I'll just try the speakers and the mic, and I was quite surprised, actually. One thing to notice, obviously, because you're dealing with propagation and energy loss, as you would with RF as well, the further away your reflector is, the less of the audio that's going to bounce back. So just imagine that from the speakers you have this chirp that's coming out, this frequency that's coming out, that's increasing, hits the bottom of the plate, and then comes back, and that chirp will arrive at a slightly different time as to when it was transmitted. When you actually down-convert that, you will then have this energy come back. And I'll show you another plot where that's more obvious. So that's one part of it. Question?
Do you have to calibrate for the delay in the system?
Yeah, that's what the D is. Because at least with the audio, your receiving of the audio samples and transmission of audio samples will happen at some non-deterministic offset. If you're using a USRP, for example, and you've got one front end, or you've got multiple front ends that you can synchronize, then you don't have that issue. But it's a relatively small range. Every time I boot it up, you just move the slider and find the zero point effectively. The other part of this is that there are actually two audio channels, right? So ordinarily, with a more sophisticated phased array FMCW, say, radar system, you would have multiple antennas, and then instead of just sending out your signal and receiving range information along one particular axis, you can actually create a phased signal and beamform and sweep it across and get range information for the angles through which you're sweeping. Usually for less ambiguity and better resolution, you can use multiple antennas to create a nice beam. In this case, we've only got two speakers, but that's enough to see somewhat of a result there. Looks like I'm hitting this too hard, so I'm just gonna reset this. Unfortunately, with this particular plot, if you give it too much to draw, at least on OSX, it locks up the GUI thread, and then you can't do anything useful. Alright, so I don't know whether you'll necessarily be able to hear this. Hopefully, you can. But there's this checkbox here. Oh, never mind. What I'm going to do is I'm going to pre-check it. This seems to be the downfall of my favor toward WX widgets. They fall over on OSX a little bit. So I don't know whether you can hear that there. In fact, maybe if I hook up the audio, you'll be able to hear it because we've got nice stereo separation.
That'll be actually. Wait, the studio wasn't working for. You turn off the knob. I turned it down. The last second from the last. Yeah, that one.
Can you hear a stereo effect? It's, it should be phasing.
It's right channel only.
What?
It's right. Oh.
Back to mono.
Yeah.
Can you hear that?
There you go.
I hear that one, so if he hears this one, here.
Oh, yeah, I can tell you that.
Stand
one.
Up. Oh, you'll hear it better.
Doesn't seem to be coming out of that one.
Yeah.
Is that right?
It's quieter or something.
Maybe you can hear it from the laptop. Can you hear some phasing happening?
Yeah. It's beating.
So what's happening there is I'm feeding the chirp into the left channel, and then I'm taking that same chirp, but before I feed it out to the right channel, I just multiply it by a sine wave, a complex sine wave, that's essentially rotating or has the frequency of the phasing rate. So what you're doing is you're essentially changing the phase offset inside the right channel at a particular rate. And so if you think about how those left and right channels will then interfere, you'll essentially have a beam forming out to the very left, and then you'll sweep all the way to the right, and you'll keep sweeping like that. And that's kind of neat. And then you can do this little hack where I put in this SDL video sync. And then I could take the floating point samples and I turn it into the byte so that you can actually draw an image. And the width of this is the same as the point transform here that we're applying to one down converted chirp. But the height is actually the number of chirps that it takes to actually do that full sweep through the phase. So it's the zero point, or the leftmost point, is somewhere in there. I haven't calibrated for that, but the idea is that one full rotation will be captured within that image. So this image then becomes range versus angle. And so the hope is that if you hold, you know, say your hand or an object at one point throughout the phase that it's scanning through, you'll get a hot spot at that point, and then when the phase moves elsewhere, because you're forming your in this case, an audio beam, it's not actually going to hit a reflector, and then when it comes back, you don't see any energy. This doesn't work particularly well because, as I said, it's, you know, just speakers and a laptop, and the microphone is at the left speaker. Excuse me. But there is a little bit of evidence of that.
Just turn up the volume to it. Like your hand.
Pardon? The fact that it's unresponsive makes it difficult because you need to change the dynamic range so that you can see stuff. Maybe that's better? Yeah, that's better. Oh, what do you know? It happened to be perfectly calibrated this time as well. So let's see what happens. It usually works better with a small reflector like my hand. So it requires a little bit of... You can see the effect more obviously in the bottom plot. If I sort of find a sweet spot, then the amplitude of the main reflection will sort of change subtly. It's not terribly obvious, but it'll change subtly over time. Yeah, actually there, see? See on the at about the, what's that?
Is it periodic volumes?
What's the scale there? Is it 50s? Yeah, so at about sort of 75, you can see two lines that sort of become orangey-yellow, and then every, I think the phase sweep time is about 3 seconds, so you have that undulation. Can you all see that? And so now if you look at the top plot, unfortunately I can't change the settings, but those lines are there, and at sort of the, in the middle there, you see how there's a bit of a brighter spot? So that's essentially saying that the beam at that particular angle is hitting an object and there's more energy returning. Can, do you sort of see that in the top black and white one? Sorry, it's not more obvious. But that's how you create a simple phase array system. So, I mean, even for example, with these cans, and we can even try that after, we can hook them both up to the two transmit channels on the USERP and have another receiver, into an Omni or something like that, or another directional. And then we could actually sweep a phase through this line in exactly the same fashion. But that's cooler at RF because you can have entire objects that will actually reflect the energy better, and you can sweep much larger bandwidths and change your rate so you can have greater potential range resolution as well. So any questions so far? Does anybody want to have a quick go? Come on, one volunteer. Somebody, all you have to do is move your hand up and down. Okay, Neil. Thanks for putting your hand up.
How much of the audio spectrum are you covering?
All of it.
So from...
It's just sweeping from 0 to... my sample rate is 48K. So 0 to 24.
It's hard to reflect audio better.
How much are you shifting the phase by between the two speakers?
Oh, by the full rotation.
I was wondering, what if you...
You go higher.
Yeah, go higher. It's 420 amps. Well.
Higher.
Have you tried this outside?
No.
I
mean, I was thinking, yeah, outside would be the way to do it, but like probably get two stereo speakers and the microphone in the middle, we've got that. That's what I was hoping we could find the speakers.
So, if you thought about like ways to increase your dynamic range, like obviously like you're coupling with
audio?
Yeah.
I mean, a classic radar uses like a beat frequency, right? And so they couple the TX to the RX and downmix it, and then they put a capacitor in to block the DC.
Yeah.
So that's how they get all the dynamic range.
But here you have to do that after digitizing.
Right, and that's the problem. You really want to take out the DC before you digitize it to get the dynamic range.
Yeah.
It's very hard to do. Without it.
Yeah. Isn't that what you're doing here? You're homodyne, right? You're sending out...
Well, I can show you the flow graph, too. I have to admit, though, after listening this from 2 hours late last night, my ears are suffering. But really, conceptually, this flow graph is fairly simple. The reason why there are more blocks than normal is because you have to turn streams to vectors and vectors to streams, and it just adds a little bit of overhead. So what's actually happening here? Let's start down here. The audio sync is here, right? So we've got the left and right channels, and it starts... I can't even remember now. That's the input. Where's the...
Hello. It's simple, though.
How many vowels is this?
Here we go. So it starts here with the signal source. So you start with the signal source, and conveniently there's actually a sawtooth waveform. So you think about what a sawtooth is, it's just a linearly monotonically increasing... line, and then it drops back to the origin and keeps going. And that's exactly what our chirp looks like. So the first thing is then you take it, and then you going back down the bottom there. That's happening at 50 hertz. You take it down here, and that was coming down here, and then you pass it into the VCO block. So this voltage control oscillator, essentially you created this ramp voltage. And then this is going to produce the frequency and the actual chirp itself as it moves through. So the first thing you do is you pipe it off here, complex to float. It's actually just going up there to multiply blocks, so you scale it nicely for the volume coming out, and then you pass that into the left channel. That's all that you need to do to create a chirp and actually pass it out. Same applies for using an SDR, but you don't need to do any sort of complex flow conversion because you have the full bandwidth. The next thing you do is, for the phasing anyway, you need to break it apart so that you can change the phase of the other signal. So here I've got this other signal source, which is a sine wave, and it's running at a slower rate, less than 1 hertz, so you get that slow phasing. And then I do a little bit of trickery here. Remember how I had the checkbox, and you can turn the phasing on and off, the beamforming? So here actually, the amplitude is 1 here when the beamformer is on, and the constant source is 1 minus 1, which is 0. So this is outputting zeros and outputting your samples, and you add them together, so you're only seeing this. But when you turn it off, the amplitude of this goes to 0, so this is outputting zeros all the time, and this is now 1 because 1 minus 0 is 1, so then you're adding 0 plus 1, so you're just getting 1 all the time here. So let's imagine the case where this is outputting 1 when the beamformer is off. So you're multiplying your VCO by 1 again, you're doing complex to flow, you're scaling it, and then that's going into the right channel. So now you're essentially putting the same signal out on both channels, so essentially they're shooting straight up. If you were to swap this, you have this sine wave now, which, I mean, it might help you to think about it not in terms of the time domain, but think about it in the complex domain, where you have, what's a sine wave? It's a rotating phase or a particular rate. So that's going to just be rotating around your constellation. And so your argument there, the angle there is changing, and so when you multiply that by your chirp signal, you're going to be changing the phase on your chirp. And then you take the real component and put that through your right channel. And so there, that's how you're changing the phase that's going out and doing your beamform. So that goes out your audio, and then you're done. The other side of it is actually receiving it and showing what's actually on the screen. So that's up here. You've got your audio source, which is just one channel coming in. You do the Hilbert transform on it to make it a complex signal. And then that very same signal source, you have a delay there to compensate for the delay in the receive and transmit path. You pass that into a VCO again, and then into the multiply conjugate block. And what that effectively does is down-convert your chirp. So instead of just having that chirp in the frequency domain, you pull it down, and that becomes essentially a tone with any other reflections there occurring. Instead of being in the time domain, now it's been transformed into the frequency domain. And so that comes down here. You multiply that. In this case, you can either just use, if you want to apply a window to the FFT, or just do it flat top, or no window. You multiply them, and then I did this slightly tricky thing where, obviously FFTs, you're doing power twos, and then the number of samples per chirp is slightly less. So we know what the bandwidth is, we know what the chirp rate is. Turns out that in this configuration there are 960 samples for one chirp. And so what we want to do is we want to take exactly the right samples at the right time and then do an FFT on that. So we're doing one FFT per chirp to produce our plot. And so what I'm doing is I'm padding this incoming data with zeros to build it up to our transform size, which is 1024. So it's adding 64 zeros on the end. Vector to stream, do the FFT, vector to stream, chop off half the spectrum, stream to vector, complex to mag, log. So what we're essentially doing is we're taking the FFT and getting logarithmic bins for the lower part of the spectrum. And then once we've got that as a vector, we just plot it. Plot it on this modified waterfall. And that's essentially what gives you your plot with the range information. That's really all there is to it. The only other part of it is that we also take those samples coming out, make it a stream, we scale it so that the range is between 0 and 255, because now we're building an SDL video plot, and then we go float to UCHAR, and then put it into the video SCL sync. And so the width of this again is the half the FFT size, and then the height, as I said, was the number of chirps that's required to go through your full range of the beamformer. And that's how it works. So it's really, really pretty basic. I suppose I could show you very quickly if I was to turn this off. Another way to look at it is just the... just as a normal FFT without the waterfall, so you can see each individual transform. No, that's strange. This doesn't happen when I'm running it normally. If I'm running Hangouts, then it doesn't like it. All right, so let's.
I think Hangouts fills with your output with your volume.
Yeah, but the weird thing is it's not even.
Isn't it in the console? It's OpenGL error, so that's
not. Oh, that's not good.
Invalid value field.
Oh, it's happening every time. Ah.
But that.
Can we? I don't know. This happens from time to time. It's very strange. What about that? There we go. So here, the top part is showing you the audio input coming to the microphone after the Hilbert transform. So really, this is our audio spectrum here. And the reason why it looks so strange like this is because the chirp is running. And so as it accumulates the samples of the transform, you get the sort of characteristic effect. This is the equivalent of what we were seeing on that waterfall before, but this is the full transform. We chop off that half. This is the sort of the return, the DC component, if you will. And then if you look quite closely in there, I'll adjust the scale. You can see the return. So you can see as I move my hand, you have that energy signature on the right of the main, the central part here. You can see this is the reflected energy. Can everyone sort of see that? And so hopefully this sort of demonstrates that this is the output of the FFT. So this is actually looking at things in the frequency domain. But as you saw, as I was moving my hand and increasing the range, it's actually turning that time difference of the chirp coming back and doing that transformation, as I said previously, into the frequency domain. So you can use these really, you know, normal tools that we're used to using after having down-converted the chirp and actually get range information out of it without doing other sort of complex maths. So what I might show you now is, very quickly, I don't know if this will work, but if I do something like... That's all right. Can you see where this is a block that sets the rate? W, is that it there? Oh wow, it just crashed. In OpenGL? That's weird. Oh, okay. So what's happening here is, I remember now, my FFT size is determined by the chirp rate, because the lower your chirp rate, the longer time you have until the chirp finishes, so you can actually see further, because that propagate, that maximum propagation delay you have is essentially determined by the length of one chirp. And so I automatically set my FFT length based upon my chirp rate, and it was picking numbers that were way too big and allocating buffers that were too large. So if I force that to be a fixed value, maybe that'll work. But then now it's complaining. What does that say? I can't read that from here.
Keep everything.
Ah. Well, if that's the only one that's complaining, we can turn all that off. Oh, it crashed again. Unreal. Well, let's try a slightly higher rate then. Crash again. Oh well, I've just found a really nice bug. So much for that. So in the real world, you might find things such as this. Is that visible somewhat?
Mm-hmm.
This is a recording that I did of the HF spectrum many, many years ago. I think this is, what, 1 megasample wide? And you can see that they have a lot of HF radar signals out there. A lot of them are from CODAR systems that are used to actually map the surface of the ocean. There's some really cool maps in there and phase arrays and look at the Doppler effects from the movement of the surface of the ocean. But you can see lots of chirps in there. So you can actually go in there and look at the signal a little bit closer and essentially get the same sort of patterns out. So this is what you're seeing here is a chirp radar signal. And if you zoom in, we're using Boardline here. Boardline was authored by Eric Olson down the back there. One of the coolest pieces of software that I use. What you're seeing here is you're seeing the initial chirp that's coming out from the transmitter. It's nice and strong. And then you can see this additional energy just after the chirp there. And so that's actually probably energy that's either returning from ground clutter nearby the transmitter or by legitimate targets out there that are reflecting some of the energy. So what happens here is, when you take this and you actually down-convert it, this line actually ends up being pushed straight because you're essentially regenerating this same chirp and then you're doing the conjuring a multiplication, so that'll push it down. What you have to imagine is that as you're actually going through your recording, it's like there's this thing that's actually just shuffling the waterfall here across, so this line becomes straight. So you move this a little bit at the top, you move it more on the next line, you move it even more and more, and you end up shuffling the entire thing. And that way you can actually resolve these sorts of features. The last thing I'll show you quickly is what that looks like when you actually do it. Maybe. So in this one here, this is an old recording that I made I'll plug the HF spectrum. You've got the Chinese over the horizon radar here. You've got some great active ham bands. You've got, I think, Link 11 and some other interesting signals in there. HFDL used by aircraft. But what's interesting is that if you look, it's a little bit hard to see on the projector, but there are actually some chirps that start from the left and actually move across the entire spectrum. And they're actually very slow. It takes, I think, 8 seconds for it to pass across this 1 megahertz worth of bandwidth. And there are ionosomes that actually send up this chirp, have a hit the ionosphere and then the signal is received somewhere else on the Earth. And that way they can actually measure the frequency response of the ionison and then calibrate their over-the-horizon radars accordingly, for example. So what does that look like when you actually down-convert it? Hopefully my little flow graph is here. Is there one called down? Yeah. What the hell is going on? It's like all of my, oh no, it's there. So this spectrum that you're actually seeing here in the background is actually the spectrum too, and you can see some of this incredibly busy ham band. That's what this is. But I know that there are these chirps that run at, take 8 seconds to cross the spectrum. I've set a VCO, as you saw before, in my flow graph. Here, so we've got the wave coming in, throttling, but signal source, which is again the sawtooth. Frequency is 0.125 hertz, so 8 seconds. Scaling that into the VCO, and then again, doing the complex conjugate multiplication of the two, so down converting that signal, and then out to the waterfall sink. All I wanted to demonstrate to you was visualizing the fact that because it's running quite slowly in this instance, you can actually see the spectrum being slowly pushed over, and then it wraps around because it's a continual de-chirping process. And what's interesting is, something, there was that line there of the actual ion sundering that thing. If you can see, I don't know why it's so difficult to see here. There's actually a straight line right here.
Then hit the other scale button again.
So you can see that it's moving there, and maybe we're lucky we're getting another chirp. There's a straight line here. Try one more. So that straight line is actually the original chirp because it's actually quite strong. That's what you would normally see in board line. So there's actually one happening right here. I mean, these are really weak signals. There's another one happening right here. There's another one happening right there. There should be another one in the middle, from what I remember. And then it happened once, and then another chirp starts, and then another chirp starts, and there's another chirp there. And so the entire spectrum is just slowly being shifted over, so that line that was originally diagonal now becomes straight. And then when you actually zoom in and you do the... you can do a high transform FFT. Oh, look, there it was. Can you see that? See this line here? That's the chirp. So by doing that de-chirping process, that becomes straight now. And then, that's how I arrived at this plot. So that's actually, these bands, are that really active hand band? And those straight lines then, actually, if you turn the whole spectrum on its side, so now this is the FFT and this is the stepping through the chirp, that, what seemed like one single straight line that they transmitted out, actually separates out into these other components there. And so now we're looking at range information, and these responses here across the bandwidth, so how these actually change in intensity is indicative of how much of the signal at that frequency is being reflected by the ionosphere. And the fact that you've got different bands here probably indicates that there might be different layers of the ionosphere reflecting, at different altitudes reflecting the signals at different times that it comes back, and so you get that spread. So anyway, I thought it was cool, and hopefully you get a bit of a better feel for how this sort of system works and how sort of mathematically quite simple and elegant it is. So Any questions? You've all gone to sleep. Good. Nice bedtime. Pretty much.
So I have a comment. So there's a toolbox for GNU Radar, GR Radar.
Yeah.
Which is really nice.
Do you want
to... You need this. This is a good point. Okay.
So what happened to those new wireless mics you were talking about?
Next time.
Okay.
It's been hard.
These are getting terrible.
Yeah.
So there's a toolbox for GNU Radar called GR Radar, which was developed 2 years ago during Google Summer of Code, and it's actually been under active development ever since. I think this would be a cool addition, and I know the authors, the maintainers, so I'm going to suggest maybe you could pull something like that in. I know they already have FMCW and also other kinds of radar, like OFDM radar and chirps and lots of...
Well, you're the OFDM radar man.
I'm the OFDM radar man, but I'm not the GR radar man, so I don't want to take credit for that. What I'm saying is, if you're interested in radar, I think GR radar is a good place to start. It's these flow graphs are nice, but other than you, then people usually can't handle your flow graphs. So there's lots of examples if you want to get started. But they're mostly geared towards USERPs. I think I'm going to suggest adding some like some more stuff because this is really cool. So, thanks.
All right. Thanks, man. Well, I think that brings us to the end of the Cyberspectrum. Thanks for hanging in there. I think we covered a good range of topics today. So next time again we'll be in the South Bay. Next is May. I mean in San Francisco. Where does it start with S? In May. So we're going to figure out a date because we have some travel coming up and things like that. And I know this time we've been using this IR mic. It's sort of been on the blink a little bit now toward the end of the night. But I've ordered a really nice, proper wireless mic system. One's a handheld mic, and the other one's actually a lapel mic. And so next time we will hook that up, and we will continue to have excellent audio. And what's cool is that it's radio waves coming out of the microphone. Not you know what that means. So the
secure
one. These are not secure. So they're not secure. It's some $100 on Amazon. So thanks again, and see you next month.